1821, the year before Schubert wrote his unfinished symphony, saw the triumphant premiere in Berlin of Weber's opera Der Freischütz. Everything went splendidly, Weber said. Poems and garlands flew. Well, from our own century, maybe the most surprising tribute to Weber's achievement came from that apparently most un-Teutonic of French composers, Claude Debussy, who wrote that Weber was a master of every known means of interpreting the fantastic through music. Even in our own days, rich as they are in the science of orchestration, few have surpassed him. Our reviewer this evening is John Deathridge.
The atmosphere of forests and legends in Carl Maria von Weber's Der Freischütz made it hugely popular in the 19th century. The opera was itself something of a legend, quoted in political speeches by Bismarck and famous for melodies that became household tunes all over Europe. In recent times, it's been treated more gingerly. Despite its solid position in the repertory, some major conductors have never recorded it. And modern sensibilities, especially in non-German-speaking countries, haven't always suffered its satanic images and yearning for hearth and homeland gladly. Even the title's hard to translate. In German folklore, Freischütz, or Freeshooter, is a marksman in league with the devil, with whose help he obtains seven bullets that hit their target without fail. Six of these miraculous missiles are at the disposal of the marksman, but only the devil controls the seventh. In the opera, Zamiel, the black hunter, directs the seventh bullet to kill the heroine Agatha. But it's the hero Max who actually fires the bullet at a dove in a shooting competition, thinking mistakenly that he's going to win Agatha as the prize. In the original story, the heroine's killed and the hero goes mad. But Weber and his librettist Friedrich Kind decided they preferred a happy ending with a Christian and moral point to it. Divine forces intervene, and instead the bullet kills Caspar, Zamiel's evil helper. Let's begin with the hermit, who enters at the end of the opera to deliver a homily about the forgiveness of Max and the banning of the shooting competition. The hermit sung here by Franz Krass. Franz Krass with the orchestra of the Bavarian State Opera, conducted by Robert Hager on EMI. So is Der Freischütz just a ghost story with a happy, rather pious ending, a piece of transcendental humbug in a dubious 19th century tradition, or is it more than that? There are nine currently available versions, all two CD sets, and not surprisingly, they nearly all go for the spooky tale with the happy ending. This wouldn't be so bad if many weren't also disaster-prone, with some serious miscastings and indifferent singing, not to mention a dismaying lack of empathy with the opera's almost childlike vitality. The most satisfying performances tend to be in the hands of conductors like Hager, steeped in the older performing tradition of the opera in Germany. He was 82 years old when he made his recording in 1969, and his lifetime of experience with the work tells a tale of its own. He exudes tremendous authority, like the hermit in the opera. The tempi are unflappable, and the orchestral playing sure-footed, though Birgit Nielsen as Agathe, leaden-voiced and emotionally absent most of the time, sounds disenchanted with the whole enterprise. Perhaps the role simply didn't suit her. Fortunately, there's no serious miscasting in Eugen Jochum's version, made 10 years earlier in 1959, and easily one of the best recordings available. You can still get it from Deutsche Grammophon, now at budget price, and it has a good cast, including Kurt Böhme, a famously larger-than-life Caspar in his day, who surpasses even himself in conveying the frightening violence of the character.
Du musst auch mitsingen.
Lass mich.
Jungfer Agathe soll leben. Wer die Gesundheit seiner Frau das schlüg, wäre doch wahrlich ein Schuft.
Du wirst unverschämt.
Eins ist eins und drei sind drei. Drum addiert noch zweierlei zu dem Satz der Reben. Kartenspiel und Würfellust. Und ein Kind mit runder Brust bis zum ewigen Leben, bis zum ewigen Leben.
Kurt Böhme with the Bavarian Radio Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Eugen Jochum. One of Kind's and Weber's ideas in Der Freischütz was to put the powers of evil and the divine forces of good in stark opposition to one another, yet also to intertwine them in complicated ways. Jochum and Böhme prefer the stark opposition, and they aren't too worried about any political or moral subtleties that might have crept into the work to blur the distinction. Böhme intensifies Caspar's famous song wonderfully from verse to verse, and Jochum loses no time in sharpening the brilliant orchestration and devilish wrong footing of the music's accents, both much admired by E.T.A. Hoffmann and Beethoven. It's a bit overdrawn, but certainly better than the bloated histrionics of Raphael Kubelik's recording, made in the late 70s with the same orchestra. Kubelik happily adds cymbals and gongs to the orchestration in the Wolf's Glen scene, just like the bad old days when anyone felt they could add anything to a score to improve it, no matter how wonderful it was. And Decca's indefatigable sound effects team have a field day. Listen to the blessing of the last four bullets. There's no end of cracking whips, trampling horses, thunder, hail and fire, not to mention the booming presence of Zamiel himself. So hold tight. Yeah.
Thank you.
Raphael Kubelik conducting the Bavarian Radio Symphony Orchestra with Peter Maven as Kaspar and Rolf Boysen as Zamiel. This is Wizard of Oz stuff, of course, but without the playful lightness of the film. Kubelik isn't helped much either by some of his singers, particularly Hildegard Behrens as Agatha and René Collo as Max. Like Nielsen in the Hager recording, they seriously misjudged the lyrical tone of Der Freischütz with some heavy-duty singing that would be more at home in one of Wagner's music dramas. Though even there, I suspect it wouldn't be right. But the greatest difficulties conductors have had with Der Freischütz are with its deceptively normal moments, the colourful forest scene of the first act, for instance, or the bridesmaid's chorus in the third. In a famous recording from Deutsche Grammophon made in 1973, Carlos Kleiber was the first on disc to try seriously to get the opera out of its dusty cupboard. It was Kleiber's first major recording, and despite some good things, time hasn't been kind to it. A cynical pianist once told me that to make bad music sound twice as good, you play it twice as fast. Kleiber's way of shaking the dust off Der Freischütz seems to have been guided by similar advice, as you can hear from the opening of the first act. Carlos Kleiber conducting the Dresden Staatskapelle and the Leipzig Radio Chorus. Others have dealt with the supposedly banal folk music in the opera in the opposite way. Instead of conducting it too fast, they conduct it too slowly. The most eccentric example is Colin Davis in a performance with the same orchestra from Philips. There are many fine things here, among them the splendid overture and the solid shaping of the final scene in the tradition of Joachim and Heger. But the transposition of any hermit-like solemnity to the village merriment of the waltz scene in the first act is asking for trouble.
Komm, Mädchen, tanz mit mir! Ja!
Not only is it hard to imagine anyone dancing to this waltz, Davis has also seriously misunderstood it. At first, it just seems like another bit of local colour, but it soon crumbles to musical dust, like the end of Haydn's Farewell Symphony, and turns instead into Max's anguish recitative at the start of his big first act aria. The sheer force of the collapse depends on an adequate tempo for the waltz in the first place, as you can hear from this much livelier performance from RCA, conducted by Marek Janowski. Thank you.
ich nicht die Qualen, die Angst, die jede Hoffnung raubt. Für welche Schuld muss ich bezahlen? Was bei dem falschen Glück mein Haupt?
Peter Seifert, singing the beginning of Max's recitative and aria in the first act, with the German Symphony Orchestra Berlin, conducted by Marek Janowski. The problem of Max and the kind of heroism he's supposed to represent in Freischütz is a tough one, especially given the history of the work and its undoubted influence on Wagner. There are no simple answers. Does he strive for great deeds despite his skirmish with the forces of evil? Or is he introspective and thoughtful, someone who likes to sing Lieder rather than big heroic scenes? Rudolf Schock is an example of the first kind of hero, and here he is singing Max's famous entrance above the gorge in the Wolf's Glen scene in another set from RCA, this time at budget price. Rudolf Schock with Lovro von Matuschich conducting the orchestra of the German opera Berlin. Max has been goaded into the Wolf's Glen by Caspar and hardly sounds enraptured at the prospect of forging the magic bullets with him. Schock is in fairly good voice in this recording and practically turns Max into Wagner's Siegmund. The difference between the two characters is that Max is less obsessed with heroic deeds than he is with his own fears and nightmares. As he descends into the gorge, scared out of his wits, Schock makes him sound a shade too strong and fearless. Or perhaps he's just putting up some resistance to the stodgy accompaniment from Matuschich, easily the worst conducting among the versions I'm discussing. It lacks the very quality most needed in Freischütz, that is, a kind of buoyant sweep to the music, swinging from high to low in grand curves, rather like a giant roller coaster. Kleiber is very good at this and knows that it doesn't only happen at joyful moments, but in highly fraught, neurotic places as well. A bit further on in the Wolf's Glen scene, Max has terrible visions of his dead mother lying in a coffin, warning him to go back, and of a distraught Agathe committing suicide by throwing herself into a river. Caspar conjures up the last vision to persuade Max to have courage to save Agathe by climbing down into the gorge, a sure sign that Max doesn't have much courage to begin with. Peter Schreier, hardly a singer in the grand heroic style, of course, explores Max's black emotion very intelligently at this moment. He's also well supported by the fierce energy of Kleiber's conducting as Caspar lures Max into his satanic web like an evil spider.
Ooh. deiner feigen Torheit erkennst. Hier bin ich. Was habe ich zu tun?
Peter Schreier as Max and the actor Gerhard Paul as Kaspar. Max's words at the end were spoken by Hans-Jürgen Weber. Moments of brilliance like this in Kleiber's reading, including Gundula Janowitz as Agatha, are actually fewer than they seem to be when the recording first came out. The hectic tempi are often arbitrary, and the use of actors for the spoken dialogue is irritating, especially when their voices are suddenly spliced in at fast transitions from song to speech. Even in the short interchange at the end of that example, it's obvious that Max's spoken voice isn't the singer's. But despite these and other faults, Kleiber's urge to squeeze something brilliantly new out of Freischütz is still a landmark in the recording history of the opera. But it's not a patch on Harnoncourt's interpretation on Teldec. Harnoncourt has thought at length about the piece, starting with a production by the late Ruth Berghaus in Zurich he conducted in 1993. Among other things, his close study of the facsimile score, coupled with a fresh reading of the libretto, has led to some genuinely new insights into the piece. He's discovered, for instance, that Weber sometimes put a crescendo mark above the two clarinets low down in their register, but not above the other instruments. This allows the hollow sound of the clarinets to peer out of the orchestral texture, rather like the luminous eyes of the wooden owl in the Wolf's Glen scene. Indeed, this extraordinary sonority is clearly audible at the casting of the second magic bullet in that scene. This time, there's no need for extraneous effects and orchestral amplifications. Harnoncourt's hard-edged reading of the score is startling enough. Nicholas Harnoncourt conducting the Berlin Philharmonic. The Berlin Philharmonic has been associated with Der Freischütz ever since its deservedly famous performance of the work with Joseph Kielbert, recorded in the 1950s. There's certainly no lack of buoyant sweep to the music here, especially in the overture. Kielbert's brilliant rendering of the overture, though, actually makes it harder for the performers to live up to later when some of the same music comes back in the opera. His supple conducting, his handling of the rhythmic dexterity of the music, an aspect of the score many conductors fail to cope with, and the sheer verve and joyousness of the playing sweep the listener away. Before the opera's hardly begun, Kielbert leaves no doubt that it's going to have a happy ending. Berlin Philharmonic in exuberant form, conducted by Josef Keilbert on EMI. This recording is also justly known for Elisabeth Grümmer's portrayal of Agatha. There's no question she lives up to the expectations of the overture. A sensitive reading of that unforgettable moment at the centre of the opera, when she walks onto the balcony to breathe the night air, can move even listeners with the stoniest of hearts. But far less acknowledged is her ability to transform her voice by the end of the scene from this trembling inwardness into a stalwart, resolute sound that easily copes with a difficult, cabaletta-like ending. For some tastes, the voice may still not be big enough here, but in terms of range and expression, it's hard to beat. Elisabeth Grümmer. But what kind of heroine is Agatha? The differences in these recordings alone are startling. At one moment, Grümmer makes her sound like a young girl, trembling and excited about her life. At another, she's a kind of Joan of Arc of the Bohemian Forest. And in some versions, she even sounds like a redemptive heroine built to Wagnerian specifications. Though this particular reading is hard to reconcile with the score. Her relationship to her friend Enchin is also central. Harnoncourt sees them as bitchy rivals. Enchin really wants Max, who's not grand enough anyway for the high-class Agatha, whereas in Joachim's recording, they're just gossipy chums. Well, that's true of the dialogue anyway. When Irmgard Seyfried sings Agatha and Rita Streich Enchin, their fabulous voices tend to go their own way. There's a sense of golden throats on show. And Seyfried's voice in particular has such an astonishing purity and presence of its own that it seems to absolve itself from the text altogether. Agatha's cavatina in the third act is actually a prayer about death. Convinced by a dream that Max's bullet is going to kill her, Agatha fears the worst. I'm not sure you'd guess from Seyfried's bright voice, almost matter-of-fact performance. Irmgard Seyfried and the Bavarian Radio Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Eugen Joachim. Joachim's version is one of the best recordings of the old school, but it's marred by cuts. The entr'acte and entire first scene of the third act are missing, which means that an essential part of the story is lost. Why are Max and Caspar reduced to one bullet, the fatal seventh, by the time Max arrives at the shooting competition to win Agatha? Without the first scene, we can't possibly know. There's not much sign either of any significant rethinking of the piece. Too much to expect, I suppose, from such a tradition-conscious conductor. And the singers, as I've said, tend to exhibit rather than act their parts. But the tempi are excellent, and the whole has a directness and vividness that recommend it. Joachim is a worthy contender for a final recommendation, but he can't match either the sheer verve of Keilbert or the challenges of Harnoncourt's reading. Ultimately, these two versions stand head and shoulders above the rest, but for entirely opposite reasons, which makes it difficult to choose between them. What about Harnoncourt's reading of Agatha? He allows Luba Organoscheva's opulent lyrical voice to indulge in some very slow tempi indeed. Agatha becomes a high-class woman with exquisite taste, socially out of reach of Max. And she's in no danger of turning into a redemptive heroine, a kind of introverted bohemian in Isolde. In fact, her cavatina in Act 3 couldn't be less Wagnerian. Quite unlike Isolde, Agatha refuses to accept the idea of blind fate. She's never had even a smidgen of a love duet with Max, let alone a Lieberstod. And with her rarefied high notes, some of which sound as if they're going to snap at any minute, Organoscheva makes her even more melancholic and more remote from Max than ever. Organoscheva. But is this reading convincing? Harnoncourt takes Weber's tempo mark of adagio at the head of this number, perhaps too literally. The melancholy of the voice, which puts Agatha on a par with the Countess in Figaro, is in a way appropriate, considering Agatha's praying to God and trying to allay her fears that she might be about to die. But where's her youthful charm, her simple, pious ardour? The ripe, voluptuous voice is surely telling a quite different, much more pessimistic story. But the matchless optimism of Kailbert's version isn't entirely convincing either. The resolute feeling, already present in the overture, that there will be a happy ending no matter what, is more problematic once we actually get to the final scene. The fatal seventh bullet is fired at last. There's brief pandemonium, and once Agathe and everyone else realize that divine forces have intervened, and she's still alive, everything seems to be in order again. Here's Kailbert's finely nuanced reading of the start of the scene.
Schieß!
Schieß nicht, Max! Ich bin in Haube!
Thank you.
what happens next. The finale of Freischütz has been much maligned by critics who insist that Weber didn't rise musically to the dramatic occasion. And most conductors, including, I'm afraid, Kalbert, tend to barge through it, impatient for the arrival of the hermit and the happy tune at the end. But too much happens after the shot for it to be as simple as that. The next thing is the death of Kaspar. He, and not Agathe, turns out to have the prayer in death. The moment is passed over too lightly in most versions, including Kalbert's, and treated more or less as a convenient tying up of a loose plot end. Harnoncourt gives it full measure, bringing out the appalling violence of the event and the horrified reaction of those who witness it. Note the striking sonority of the orchestra, incidentally, especially those deep clarinets glaring up again from the other instruments.
So ist du dein Versprechen mir.
Death of Kaspar, sung by Matti Salminen, his best, with Harnoncourt conducting the Berlin Philharmonic and Berlin Radio Chorus. After Kaspar's terrifying end, the enormity of the sin Max has committed in colluding with the devil is clear to everyone. To keep up the momentum of the scene, Kalbert relies heavily on a glorious lineup of powerful voices, including Rudolf Schock, Hermann Prey, and Gottlob Frick, as well as Grümmer. But Harnoncourt complicates matters by insisting that Max is a bookish anti-hero who prefers to read Goethe rather than put on his huntsman's boots and sing like an invincible Helden tenor. Max's stunned confession to the reigning Prince Ottokar is unbearably contrite, so much so that Harnoncourt practically allows the action to stop in its tracks. The precariously poised bassoon solo, beautifully played here by an unnamed member of the Berlin Philharmonic, tells all. Hendrik Wottrich as Max and Wolfgang Holzmeier as Prince Ottokar. Harnoncourt is interested in how primitive superstition and an almost medieval dualism between good and evil fare alongside characters who behave psychologically in a very modern way. A According to his interpretation, this conflict, if it is a conflict, is at the centre of the work. And the musical details superb, in part because he's restored the extremely refined dynamics of Weber's original score that have been ironed out through generations of routine performances. Good, it's no longer the lovable old warhorse it once was. If you want that, Kielbert's inspiring performance can't be bettered, despite the age of the recording. But Harnoncourt's version is a revelation on a dramatic level as well, proving convincingly that the opera's more ambitious and unsettling than it's usually taken to be. I'll leave you with the ensemble just before the end. In most performances, it sounds like a formality. Max has been forgiven, and everyone's thankful they've been delivered from evil. But Harnoncourt realizes that Weber's actually written a waltz with a gentle, mesmeric lilt reminiscent of the village merriment in the first act. Only this time, no one's dancing. According to the score, Agathe sings pointedly to the prince and not to Max, and everyone else sounds as if they're treading carefully on thin ice, aware that with each step they could still come to grief. It's a happy end, but only just.
Private affirmations before the public rejoicing at the end of Weber's Der Freischütz. Lieber Orgenaschewer as Agathe, Endrik Wottrich as Max, Wolfgang Holzmeier as the Prince, Gilles Cachemay as Kuno, and Christina Schaefer as Ännchen, with Niklaus Harnoncourt conducting the Berlin Philharmonic Orchestra. And that live recording made in 1995, excuse me, is John Deathridge's top recommendation. It's a 2-CD set from Teldec with the number 450 99 77 582.